Welcome back to Hot Copy. The youth have a stake in the future. That's why the World Economic Forum is trying to put them at the forefront of campaigns to improve education and the lives of the poor. Here's a look at some of the young faces shaping the future today.
The youth is said to be the future of the world. Statistics indicate they make up 50% of the global population. This astounding statistic inspired the World Economic Forum to create the Global Shapers Community, an international community of young leaders aimed to help improve the state of the world. At least 9 global shapers from various fields have since been tapped in the Philippines, each with their own passion, vision, and advocacy. Lynn Pinugu supports Mano Amiga, an academy aimed at providing education to poor Filipino families to help uplift their lives. Meanwhile, environmentalist Anna Oposa co-founded the Save Philippine Seas, an online and offline movement to protect the world's richest marine resources. Palawan Mayor Pai Alvarez, who is just in her 20s, aims to introduce sustainable projects in her scenic town. The country's global shapers hope to expand the Manila hub by getting more Filipinos to join the campaign of shaping the world by creating social change.
And joining us on Hot Copy, World Economic Forum Global Shapers. Actually, there are 3 out of 9 core members of the Global Shapers Manila hub. Let me introduce you to the 3 who were invited to attend the World Economic Forum in Davos just this January. We have here Eleanor Lynn Pinugu. She's the founder of Mano Amiga, an international school for the underprivileged children. Environmentalist Anna Oposa, who is the co-founder of Save the Philippine Seas. And Mayor Pai Alvarez of San Vicente, Palawan, the youngest mayor, I believe, in the Philippines today. Good day to you, ladies.
Good morning.
My God, you guys look way too gorgeous in the morning. Ang gaganda nyo naman.
We wanted to match you.
Okay, all right. Okay, now I'll ask Lynn first. Lynn, talk about the Global Shapers Manila Hub. What is it?
Okay, so this year, World Economic Forum decided to include the youth because they believe we have the biggest we're the biggest stakeholders in the future. And so the World Economic Forum decided to invite 70 young members, 70 extraordinary young individuals from all over the world. So right now, there are different shapers, global shapers all over the world, arranged in different hubs.
Okay.
So the 3 of us were part of the Manila hub. And the goal is to just gather extraordinary young leaders to come up with an inaugural project to make a difference in their local communities.
All right. Now, Anna, tell us, who can be a global shaper? I mean, I know the answer to this, of course, I formed them, but who can be a global shaper of the Manila hub?
We're looking for people between 20 to 30 years old who have extraordinary achievements and have started something that made a positive impact in the community.
Okay.
And we're looking for people with the X factor. So it's not enough that you
know,
it's not enough that you know you're a good leader, you have good grades or whatever. There has to be something extra factor.
Okay. Yeah. All right, Pai, you are the youngest mayor in the Philippines. I'm correct. Now you're 24.
Youngest female. Yes, 24.
Are there young male mayors?
I believe
you're 24. Oh.
Yes, but I believe I think before the election previous to when I won, a male candidate had won at a younger age.
Okay. Now who can be the members of the Global Shapers? You know, in the Philippines we are very cynical about politicians, but what range of people or young leaders can be in the Global Shapers?
It really ranges from personalities from A to Z. You know, I am a politician, Anna is an environmentalist, Lynn is an educator. Oh. Our other shapers are doctors, studying to be lawyers,
social entrepreneurs.
Broadcast journalists.
Yes. Yeah, so I mean honestly it's just individuals who are committing to shaping the world.
Yeah.
And that's really what the World Economic Forum is all about, is getting these different individuals from different sectors, whether it be education, business, politics, NGOs, and getting them together and then having our ideas and concepts just collide and, you know, we create something good for the world.
Okay. Now, the World Economic Forum, the yearly convention in Davos, Switzerland, as they say, is the hot ticket to get into every single year. Leaders from all over the world, businessmen, philanthropists, stars. It's the one convention that Angelina Jolie is seen each and every time. This year, Bill Gates was there. Mick Jagger dropped by. And it's the one thing that you have to be invited to actually attend. You can't choose, you can't pay for it. And three members are of the Global Shapers Manila Hub were invited. So we're gonna show you some photos of their experience in Davos, Switzerland. And let me start with Lynn. Lynn, you were invited. Oh, there's the three of you. Actually, now tell us about this experience, okay?
Okay, it was really nerve-wracking for the three of us, also because we knew how exclusive and how important this could be.
Oh, Obama Kino's right there, you can see on there. And Tony Meloto of Gawad Kalinga. Okay, go ahead.
So this how
important... Wait, stay that. Pause that. Go on.
Okay,
pause
so this that. Is my Davos moment, one of my Davos moments. We got to share the stage with Professor Schwab, but at the same time, we got to share it with Desmond Tutu.
Yes.
An archbishop, he's so amazing. He told us to just keep dreaming of a world without war and where poverty is history. So okay. For us, this was such an incredible moment.
All right, now this is the plenary. We should explain that the plenary moment is where like 2,000 people are watching. You're in the stage too, Anna, no?
Yes.
But you're just not
I'm
seeing
right.
the No, because you are on the stage. Is this photo zoomed
she
in?
She actually was the one who made sure to stand like, in front.
Yeah.
So
next
that we could be next
all right,
to Desmond
Tutu. All right, Pai is next to Desmond Tutu, and that's Lynn between Desmond and Klaus Schwab.
Yeah.
All right, now tell us about Anna, this experience. Because you were invited to actually speak.
Yeah, but at the last minute, they canceled the speaking engagements of all of the young people. Because, well, how can you compare to Desmond Tutu, right?
Yeah.
But it's where, you know, I was able to meet some of my heroes, like oceanographers from National Geographic.
Yeah.
And one of them was Sylvia Earle. And during her talk, I cried from beginning to end.
Oh, my.
And I approached her because she's the first female. She's like the Amelia Earhart of the ocean. And after her talk, I went up to her and I said, so much of what you did inspired what I do. And
yes.
She said, we have the power to do it, so
okay.
We should go for it.
All right. Derek, can you put that photo back, the one with the whole line of Global Shapers? And I'd like you guys to introduce who the nine core members are. This was a launch that we held recently. Each hub launches their Global Shapers, so you know the kind of young people that we get in the team. Okay, can you show the picture again? All right, go ahead. Any of you, Pai, you can start.
Right,
with, yeah, Fernando Zobel on the, who is not a Global Shaper. Yeah, he's age exceeding. All right, I'm kidding.
Barely.
Yeah. This, the next to him.
Yes, this Ponce.
Ponce Samaniego, yes. Who is, you can describe him. Lynn, any of you.
He is a social entrepreneur who co-founded Outliers, which is a nonprofit that serves people who serve. So they provide sustainable solutions for nonprofits.
Okay.
And then there's Mildred Ople, who's a law student.
Mildred's in black. The one in the black.
The one in between Lynn and Anna.
All
yes.
Right.
She's a law student and she has projects in Bulacan, in her hometown, for the youth to develop agricultural projects. And then beside her is Jaya Boneta.
Behind her.
It's Jaya Boneta, who founded Philippine Funds for Little Kids.
Yeah, he's kind of famous already.
Yes.
Go ahead.
The aim of the org is to raise funds for children all over the Philippines.
So they don't have to swim to school.
So they don't have to swim to school. Because he discovered that in southern Philippines, people have to swim to school. There's Brian Lim, who is a doctor. And his advocacy is to bring public health to far-flung areas in the Philippines.
Yes, and then there's Sexy Pie.
There's Sexy Pie. And then there's Sexy Alex Aduka as well, who started the Youth Council of Habitat for Humanity. And of course, who doesn't know Bianca Gonzalez, who is a UNICEF ambassador.
How about the one in the last?
And our mentor. And our global shaper.
Our global leader.
So what did you learn when you went, I mean, your experience in Davos, what were the highlights of your experience? Tell us about that. Let's start with Pai.
Well, for me, I really didn't know what to expect. I mean, I, you know, heard of Davos. I know of Davos because, you know, I watched CNN. I went to business school. So it's this really elite community of, you know, sort of a convergence. And when I got there, it was so surprising and overwhelming that I got to meet, you know, somebody who invented something in the tech industry or royalty or... heads of state that I would never get the opportunity to meet. You know, I opened the door for Angela Merkel in the bathroom. And you know, her bodyguard was kind of like, stop. I'm like, no, global shaper. I will not harm her. But you know, it's just something that you'll never get on a normal basis, and Davos is truly a magical experience.
Yeah, but did you have aha moments as a politician? I mean, you were a politician every single day, but when you went to Davos, did something click in you or something sparked in you?
Yeah, well, when I was there, I wasn't really, you know, the mayor or anything. I wasn't wearing a cap saying, you know, look here, I have power, authority. No, when I was there, it was all equal.
Yeah.
And especially when Desmond Tutu spoke and he said, we all have to understand that, you know, we should take a step back.
Yes.
And not be so serious, you know. And we've seen the world collapse because of how serious we've taken the state of the world to. And so when he said that, you know, parang just sit back, understand who you are and know yourself. That just made me, you know, reassess at what I'm doing and not doubt myself. Because, you know, politics is a little bit difficult in the Philippines.
Yes.
And it's very, very challenging. Yes. So when he said that, and coming from him who's so, you know, you can look at him and you really, really just think twice about yourself. And
another thing I was going to say, I mean, Filipinos are very cynical about politicians. We don't, I mean, sorry to say this, but we don't exactly introduce politicians. Oh my God, my daughter's the mayor of so-and-so, or with pride. But when you were in Davos, I saw it myself. You became known as, are you the 24-year-old mayor? And you must have felt, oh my gosh, they don't look down at politicians in other parts of the world.
Yeah, when I give them my business card, they're like, you're really the mayor. I'm like, yeah, it's not a joke. I didn't make this up to get into Davos. No. Yeah. And they ask me all these things and then they offer to want to help, because when they see somebody like me who's young, who's out of the box, probably a fresh take on local politics, they're more interested and they're more, you know, they want to hear about all my projects and hear about all my stories and laugh and just,
Yeah. Okay. Now, Ana Oposa, I hope that they find the photos for, so that we have photos as we describe each of them there. Oh, there you go. Oh my Lord. This is the photo for the co-founder of the Philippine Seas. All right. Now, Ana Oposa, a lot of you will, she's actually the daughter of a well-known, and oh my God, a well-known environmentalist, Tony Oposa.
Yes.
Okay. Now, Ana, tell me about your Davos experience, because you were like, other than picked up by almost every single person I know. Go ahead.
Davos experience was, I think one of my favorite moments was really being in the shuttle from the Congress Center to
People
to
should
our
know
house.
You're only 23. Huh?
Yes. Okay. I turned 24 last month.
Boy, happy birthday.
in the shuttle, that's where we met the founder of Dropbox. That's where we met the CSB producer.
CBS
producer.
Okay.
We met royalty. We met the head of the Yale Environmental and Public Policy Department. So that was incredible, you know, sharing the car with these established people.
Yeah.
And then another favorite moment was realizing that to be able to commit to improving the state of the world, there is a need for collaboration.
Yeah.
Meaning you can't just move forward focusing on one advocacy. And you can see that with the three of us.
Why do you want to save the Philippine Seas? And I'm not asking you as a cynical question. I mean,
right.
We all know we have to save the Philippine Seas.
Yes.
But why do you personally you're doing this full time?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, I grew up with a dad who's an environmental lawyer. He's the foremost environmental lawyer in the country. And I guess when you have a dad who's more mental than enviro, your perception of the world changes. And I got my diving license when I was 15 years old. So I've been diving for 8 years. And it's just, you know, when you see how rich the seas are, you are inspired to protect it. And the Philippines is the richest marine life in the entire world.
No, that's what amazes me with the three of you, is you can actually be hip, sexy, and a nerd. I mean, you know, usually people think when you're nerds, you need to be really geeky, but the three of you are such cool nerds. Now, what's very interesting, you will be leaving in a few months, and you are going to be getting a grant. I won't say from where or what, but it's a lot of money, something like, I can announce how much, no? Like 50,000 euros to be given to Ana Oposa, the 24-year-old. Now tell us why you are getting 50,000 euros.
I'm leaving on Monday, actually, and I'm going to fly to Europe to receive the award. It's an international environmental award, and I'll be the first Filipino to receive it. So that's what I'm most proud of.
Yeah, in a mini skirt.
Yes, because we have to put the Philippines in the map in conservation. I'll be building a shark sanctuary in the Visayan Seas.
I'm so proud of you.
Thank you.
Are you the first Filipino to actually plan a shark sanctuary?
No, there's like the whale sharks in Donsol.
Yes.
But this is the one for thresher sharks in the Visayan Sea.
What kind of sharks?
Thresher.
Yeah. They're not male. No, I'm kidding.
Oh my God.
No. Okay. That is having fun.
Yeah. All right. Now, Lynn Pinugu is the head of the Global Shapers Manila Hub. Now, Lynn is the founder of a school. If we can show some photos. Oh, there's shots of you in Davos. Yeah. Now, wait, pause this. Tell us about this moment in Davos.
Okay, so they asked different shapers to talk about the experience during Davos, and I was chosen to represent the Philippines. So they interviewed me along with Ahmad, who is from Jordan, to share experience so far, like the people we've met, our best Davos moments. And this was actually taken before I presented to Ideas Lab, so I was quite nervous during the time. But what's amazing about this day is Ahmad, he ended up helping me to improve my presentation along with Anna and Pai. So actually, I'm very grateful for this interview, because without it, I wouldn't have been close to him, and they wouldn't have really helped me in improving.
Yeah. And we just want to share that he just came from the Philippines.
Yeah, yes, yeah.
Yeah, he flew here to visit, and he went to San Vicente with us because he wanted to help Pai improve the economic situation. Because he works in the investment board of Jordan.
Oh, really? Yeah. All right. Now I want to ask, Lynn owns a school. It's called Mano Amiga. I visited it already. It's actually it's somewhere in Taguig.
Yes.
All right, talk about your school. What you're seeing now are photos of a school that Lynn, at how old were you when you put this up?
I was 23.
At 23,
I was a co-founder. I don't own it. I was a co-founder of Mano Amiga Academy. It's an international school for underprivileged children. And it also serves as a community center. So we don't just offer education. We really try to provide holistic development, not just to the children enrolled in our school, to their families, but also to the families of the surrounding community.
All right. What do you mean by an international school for the underprivileged?
Okay,
what does that mean?
So Mano Amiga is actually a model that started in Mexico in 1963, and I encountered it when I was living there as a youth missionary.
Were you really a youth missionary?
Yes, I really was a youth missionary.
Are you serious? I'm so impressed.
Okay, so what it does is Mano Amiga schools, they use an international curriculum, they use an international pedagogy. And the reason why I decided to bring it to the Philippines with the team of the congregation behind it was because when I was there, I was so impressed by the way the children would carry themselves. They were so confident. You wouldn't think that
they were poor.
Correct.
Okay.
And I realize it's because these children, they're aware of their sense of dignity.
Yeah.
They know that they shouldn't anchor their security based on material resources.
Yeah.
And at the same time, because they were given a scholarship, they were so grateful that the school is working with them and with their family. So they really work hard. So those are really the stories I want to see here in the Philippines as well.
So you have 90 students.
Right now we have 90 students. We're growing another class next year because we try to grow one level every year. So this coming June we'll be accepting new batch of kindergarten
and
students.
And how does the school survive?
Okay, so before Mano Amiga schools used to rely, especially
this is you speaking in Davos.
Yes, it's me speaking in Davos. We used to just rely on donations from private individuals and from grants. But 2 years ago when Andoy happened, I realized that we needed to find develop a more sustainable model for the school. So what we did is we set up a social enterprise. It's called Bistro 3846, and it's a cafeteria in an international school in Everest Academy. And 100% of the profit goes to sustaining the scholarship fund of the students.
Yeah.
At the same time, it's providing employment opportunities for the mothers.
Yes.
The Everest Academy families are happy because we're serving their children healthy, age-appropriate meals. So that's how we plan to really sustain the school for the long term.
All right. Okay. Now we'll take a quick break. When we return, we'll continue our conversation with the three sexy global shapers. Now, Lynn, Anna, and Pai Hot Copy will be right back. We'll be asking your questions.